Okay, so thank you to Isabel. And now we I'd like to introduce our next speaker. I'd like to invite to the stage Dennis Janot, Director of Field Engineering for Solo.io. Dennis, good afternoon. Thank you for joining us.
Good afternoon. Thank you. So I'm going to speak about advanced authentication pattern at the edge. And I think it's quite a good flow to do this talk after Isabel, because some of the things resonate well, I think, in this presentation. So as you said, I'm working at Solo.io, and I'm director of field engineering here in EMEA. So you have my details if you want to contact me later. A little bit of background, right? So everyone knows that we are moving from like monolith to microservices, and most of these microservices tend to be deployed on Kubernetes today. And what we see is that at the beginning, when we start to have a few services running on Kubernetes, we tend to just like expose them through ingress controller like Nginx or HAProxy, and it does the job. You can secure it with TLS, and you can do some basic routing. But very quickly, when you start to have like more and more services deployed in your cluster, you discover that each team reinvents the wheel, and you would see like some web applications are secured with OIDC, some other APIs are exposed and secured through Jolt token, for example, API keys and so on. And it creates multiple challenges that I'm going to speak about in a few minutes. But you will see, I think it will resonate quite well with the talk that Isabel did just before. So there is this thing happening, but there is also like a lot of other security aspects that are generally configured outside of the Kubernetes cluster, like rate limiting, web application firewalling, and so on, right? So it creates like several challenges, right? The first challenge is about like the fact that everyone reinvent the wheel and implement, OIDC or these different flows in their different applications, perhaps using different languages and so on. And the implementation are always different. And instead of spending time doing that, the team should focus more on the business logic. And the other aspect, the other issue is about like the fact that the security team doesn't have visibility on what's configured. So if you look at the previous talk, the discussion was about like how you secure your APIs, but obviously you want to understand how they are currently secured to improve that, right? And if every application is configuring its authentication mechanism, authorization, and so on in a different way, it becomes very difficult to know what's going on, right? So it's another challenge, this visibility that you don't have about how these APIs or UIs are secured. And as I said, some mechanism needs to be configured outside of the Kubernetes cluster. So that becomes quite tricky, because on one side, you want to use like a GitOps approach to deploy all your application on Kubernetes and having everything as code. And then you need to configure an external component where you cannot really use this infrastructure as code approach. And that kind of break a little bit the flow in the way you deploy and maintain your applications. So that's why like we see a lot of people trying to find and adopt like a Kubernetes native API gateway. So what we mean by that is that this is like an API gateway that you deploy in Kubernetes that you can configure as code through Kubernetes objects, and that you can use to implement the security like OIDC flow and Jolt tokens and API keys and so on, but also use to implement like rate limiting and WAF and doing like much more, so that now the application team can focus on the business logic. They don't need to implement this security mechanism in their application, and they can also, it also gives like visibility for the security team, right? So the security team knows just by looking at the configuration of this API gateway exactly how each API or web application is secured, right? So it's very useful for that. And it's not because it's run on Kubernetes that it cannot be used to expose services that are running outside of Kubernetes, like traditional VMs, or even expose services running in Lambda functions and so on. So I already, I think, went through all these benefits. I hope it makes sense. And what I'm going to do is that I'm going to speak a little bit more about like our API gateway at Solo that is doing what I've just described. So it's called Glue Edge, and is based on Envoy, which is quite interesting because you probably all heard about Envoy. It's the Envoy proxy is part of the CNCF, so the same foundation as Kubernetes. It's used at very large scale by many large companies. It's really also powerful in the way you can extend it, and I will speak about it in a minute. And it's really the foundation for several API gateways like ours, but also for most of the service mesh solutions that you can find out there. And the reason why it's so popular in the service mesh world is because it has been really built to be dynamically configured by what we call a control plane in service mesh. So if you look a little bit more about the way Glue Edge is architected, basically you get these filters. So this notion of filter we have in Envoy, so that when a request comes in, it goes through, it goes through multiple filters, and the filters can modify the request, can take decision like rejecting the request and so on. So sometimes to take a decision, this filter needs to communicate with an external component. For example, if I want to secure my web application with OIDC, then I would have this external auth filter that will send a request to an external authentication server to implement the workflow and decide if the call should be allowed. So basically, it can be something like redirecting the user to the page of the identity provider, and then when the user just enters his credential, then it goes back to the applications, and the gateway is exchanging the token and so on. And then it can be like applying rate limiting to protect your API or UI against like people abusing the system. And that would also, you know, contact a rate limiting server that's part of Glue Edge, which will track all the requests coming for different users, or you can even track that based on some information you extract from a JWT token and things like that, and that can decide if the request should be allowed or rejected. Some filters are implemented directly inside Envoy. So for example, we built a web application firewall filter based on mod security, which is running directly in Envoy, doesn't even need to communicate with an external component. We have like a filter for doing like advanced transformation, taking some data from the body, putting that in a header or things like that. And also like a JWT filter, for example, where we can validate a JWT token, we can extract some claims from the JWT token to add a new header. So it's very useful, for example, because if you say, I want to perform the authentication at the gateway level, then I still need to tell the application who is the user that has been authenticated, and passing this information through header is very useful. So when we say it's Kubernetes native, it's really that you can drive all its configuration through Kubernetes object. So you create like these virtual services and route table and so on, where you define how you want to secure your application. And because everything can be done that way, it means that it's GitOps friendly and so on, right? So I really try to go fast on the slides because I think it's easier to understand the benefits when you see a demo. So in this demo, I have like a Kubernetes cluster where I have like this API gateway deployed. I have like my a few applications deployed there, and I deploy KeyCloak as an identity provider. So I already deployed KeyCloak, and I already created two users, one called user one, which has a solo email, and one user two, which has a different email address. So you will see it will be useful at some point in my demo. And then the first thing I do is that I create a Kubernetes secret based to store the KeyCloak secret. And after that, what I do is that I create this auth config so that I can give to the gateway all the information I need to perform the authentication with OIDC. And because it's a separate object, what's very nice is that then you can really decide where you use it, right? So you don't have to repeat yourself multiple time in your in the configuration of your gateway. Instead, you just have to reference this auth config object, and you can do that at the virtual service level. So that means that it will be applied to any request for your the specific domain where you created this virtual service, but it can be at the root level so that you want some of the routes to be secured and some not. For example, it's very common that you want to secure the access to some dynamic web pages, but you want to disable the authentication if it's for like static content, right? I don't want necessarily to perform authentication for CSS files or things like that, depending on the use case. So now that I've done that, if I try to access my web page here, as you can see, I am redirected to KeyCloak, which is the identity provider I'm using here. And with my tab, then if I log in here, it will redirect me to the web page because the authentication has been successful. So it's a very simple example. I will show you after like a little bit more complex one where we don't perform only authentication, but also authorization. Another common request is like requirement is about rate limiting. So you can again create like a rate limit config object where you define a limit. You can see here it's a very basic one where I would set a limit to 10 requests per minute for anyone who would use my application. And I then reference my rate limits in my virtual service like I did before for the external authentication. And if I go here and I try to abuse the system and send too many requests, at some point I will get like a 429 response code because I reached the limit basically. So that's a very simple example with this rate limit config. You can also have like a use case that is quite common, which is like I want a different rate limit for authenticated user or for anonymous users, right? So that makes sense. But we can do implement rate limiting with far more advanced patterns, right? We can say I authenticate my user, I get a JWT token. From this JWT token, I extract two claims, one that represents the tenant and one representing the user, for example. And I define the tenant limit and the user limit, and the first that is reached then is enforced, right? So it's it can be, as I said, you know, very advanced cases. We can also protect the application with a web application firewall. So one use case, for example, is to limit the payload. So if you have an API and you want to allow people to send some data in a put request or post request or whatever, perhaps you want to make sure that they cannot be bigger than the limit. Like here we do an example with just like a 1 kilobyte limit, as you can see here, but it can definitely be like a bigger limit. And we can try it out like with this other API that is not secured. And you can see if I start to send more than one a kilobyte, then I get this error message telling me that it's not allowed, right? And we have implemented mod security in a filter. So that's an example with the payload size, but it can be a lot of things like looking at the user agent. It can be doing like IP whitelisting, all these kind of things, right? As I said, we can do so like data transformation. You say if the status is 429, for example, I want to change the response of the body, like something like that. You can do a lot of transformation. What's very interesting that you can do transformation before and after you do the authentication, for example. So you can say before authentication, I want to look at the authorization header. And if there is the bearer keyword space and then the token, I want to remove the bearer space and just have the token. And then I can allow people to use this header with or without the bearer keyword, for example. Or you can do manipulation after the authentication if I want to change a header that I created from a JWT claim. So that's another use case. But as I said, you know, the authentication is nice, but what's very common as well is to perform authorization. So you can use like our OPA library that is in our X.Dot server so that you chain together the authentication and the authorization. And what's nice again is that you don't even need an OPA server for that. You can just like provide your rule using this language that is used by OPA that's called Rego. You can provide this Rego rule directly in a Kubernetes config map. So you can see here, I want to check that the email end with solo.io, right? So currently I am logged in with a user that has an email ending with solo.io. So that should work, right? Because I am in the case of like an allowed user, right? So if I refresh here, you can see that I can access it. Now, if I open like an incognito window where I am not logged in and I try to log in and use like user two and the same password, then this user doesn't have an email that finished by solo.io and it's rejected, right? So it gives you like an idea about how we can combine this authentication and authorization and so on. But again, it was really just like a quick overview that I wanted to give you here. Just also wanted to highlight a few other things. So part of the Glue Edge Enterprise, you also get something we call Glue Portal, which is a way for you to expose your API. So instead of creating the virtual service and auth config like I did manually, basically what you do is that you have this Glue Portal layer that will discover your APIs based on open API specification, or even can do use gRPC reflection if it's a gRPC service. And you will create like what we call API docs from there. And you can group together these API docs into an API product. So imagine you have 5 microservices. Each microservice has its own open API spec. I want to combine all of them together into one public facing API, right? So that's what you do with the portal, and then you expose it to the outside world. You create like a portal UI that the users can log in to and can use to see the documentation of your API and so on. And what Glue Portal does is that behind the scene, it just like translates all this configuration into the Glue Edge configuration. So it's just like a way to really nicely expose your APIs without having to create a lot of complicated configuration in Glue Edge. Instead, letting Glue Portal doing that and having different branding for your users and so on. Also wanted to highlight quickly, we are very active in the Istio community, and we have our management plane for Istio, when especially useful when you have like multiple Istio cluster. And part of it, we have something called Glue Mesh Gateway, which basically we took all the features that you have seen in Glue Edge and we make them available in the Istio Ingress Gateway. So just so that you are aware, everything I have described so far is available on Kubernetes without Istio, but is also available on Kubernetes with Istio. And the Glue Portal can either create the configuration for Glue Edge or create the configuration for the Glue Mesh Gateway. So, yeah, I hope it was useful. I wanted to keep like a few minutes for questions. Just wanted to highlight that we are very, very active on Slack. So if you have like any question, you want to continue the discussion, just register on slack.solo.io and you will find me and my team here and we'll be very happy to help you.
Great. Thank you, Dennis. We've got a couple of questions coming in, and I'll start with the first from Gabriel. What do you use for observability and monitoring transactions through the gateway?
So that's a very good question. So basically, the way Envoy works is that you have these access logs that you can configure with a lot of granularity, and you can define the format like in JSON or something else. But you can also, it's very powerful because you can access a lot of different information, right? So you can say, I want to expose in my access log what was the method used. I can expose the duration, but I can also expose something that is very powerful. It's called response flags. Because one of the things people really want to do is that when they have these logs is also to be able to understand when I have an error, generally you get a 503 response code and you don't know what's going on. So these response flags, basically, they give you more information about what is the reason of this error. Is it the upstream that's disconnected? Is it that the client that disconnected? Is it something else, right? So it's really powerful. So we do that for the access logs. We just generally configure them correctly so that we get the information we need. And what we do as well is that we have for the observability, we also have all the metrics that are published by GlueEdge that are stored in Prometheus. And then we provide Grafana dashboard where you can see the status of the control plane. So I can check if my configuration is currently applied in Envoy or if there is an issue here. And then I can go also through other dashboards where I can see statistics for each of my backend, each of my upstream. So this application received this number of requests and has this number of errors and these performance metrics and so on.
And this the next question from the audience may be a little more philosophical. So and perhaps this is something that we could take off to Slack or another channel. But the general question is do we introduce more risk by moving authentication to the edge? Or are you suggesting that this edge authentication is in addition to what we do at a service layer?
I would say it really depends, right? We see all kind of approach, right? So for example, currently the bigger problem that we see everywhere is that there is no visibility about what is done by the application. So nobody can tell you, okay, I have 100 applications that I have exposed. Are they secure today? Nobody knows, right? Or nobody knows. You have to ask each application team, right? So it gives you this visibility when you have that in the gateway, right? In the edge. And then in terms of who should do what, it's kind of a collaborative work, right? Because you do authenticate at the edge, which I think is a really good practice. But then the authorization, it will really depend, right? Some teams don't have any authorization performed yet, right? They just do authentication, and they would be happy to leverage the authorization I have shown with a config map and defining Rego rules, right? Some other applications, a lot, already have authorization in place. So now what we do is that we remove this authentication from their responsibility, but they can still continue to enforce authorization. And it's just a matter about agreeing about how I pass information about my user, right? It can be I just pass my JWT token to the application so that they will also have access to, even if I did my first authentication, I can still pass the JWT token to my application. Sometimes it could be, no, I don't want that because I don't want to decrypt my JWT token on the application side. Then you can do that at the gateway and just pass a header with some information. So it's a collaborative work at the end. Mm-hmm. But at least, when you do authentication and rate limiting and WAF at the gateway level, you have already done a lot of protections, right? And then you can still enforce some other things on the back end. Obviously, I didn't speak about service mesh. You can also have this service mesh layer that also allow you to tell which services can be exposed, which services can be accessed by the gateway, which service can talk to which services. So you have a lot of other discussions that are really interesting in this topic.
Oh yes, service mesh is supposed to be its own track at some point.
Exactly.
So thank you so much, Dennis.